The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ be with you and also with you. Good morning on this Mother's Day. Happy Mother's Day to all of you and welcome to worship at Conyers Presbyterian Church. I am delighted to be with all of you this day. A couple of announcements before we begin our service. I wanted to let you know that in some process to begin getting back to normal life, next Sunday, May 17th, we will be doing a live stream of our worship service here in the sanctuary. Hold on, you're not invited quite yet. It's just going to be limited to staff, pastors, and musicians who will be presenting the service. But it is an effort to get back to some semblance of normalcy. You should have received an email this week explaining how that's going to work. Your session is hard at work making plans to keep everyone safe and do what needs to be done, but next week's worship service will look a little bit different. Let us worship God. Will you join me in the call to worship from Psalm 31 using the words printed in your bulletin? In you, O Lord, I seek refuge. Do not let me ever be put to shame. Incline your ear to me. Rescue me speedily. Be a rock of refuge for me, a strong fortress to save me. You are indeed my rock and my fortress. For your name's sake, lead me and guide me. Into your hand I commit my spirit. You have redeemed me, O Lord, faithful God. Let us worship God. Join me in the prayer of confession using the words printed in your bulletin, first together in collective confession and then silently in individual confession. God of mercy, whose loving kindness endures forever, we confess that often we have failed to receive and to give love, to care for others as we care for ourselves, to forgive and accept forgiveness. We remember good intentions that were not put into actions, harsh words that were hurtful, selfish purposes that caused pain, persistent pride that would not yield. We acknowledge our fear in the face of this pandemic and our failure to accept the hope you offer us in Christ. Hear us, O Lord, as in this silence we make our confessions to you. to you. Gracious God, forgive us and help us to forgive others. Heal us from the pain of self-condemnation. Free us from the burden of failures that cannot be corrected. Renew us with your loving assurance that our sins have been forgiven through Jesus Christ, our Redeemer. Amen. People of God, in Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Not because you did something special to earn God's love and forgiveness, but because Jesus died on the cross for you, and because God's grace is a free gift given to all. In Jesus Christ, we all are forgiven. Amen.
Our scripture reading today comes from the Gospel of John. It's a very familiar reading. And I've read it many times, you've probably heard it many times, but most of the times I've read it have been at funerals. And it's appropriate text for a funeral because it is Jesus comforting his disciples as Jesus is making his way to the cross. So I think it's probably an appropriate text for us today as we struggle with grief in many senses in this period of isolation and quarantine and social distancing and all of that. So we're reading from the Gospel of John, chapter 14, beginning at verse 1. Listen again for the word of the Lord. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God, trust also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, I would have told you, I am going there to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me so that you also may be where I am. You know the way to the place where I am going. Thomas said to him, Lord, we don't know where you are going, so how can we know the way? Jesus answered, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you really knew me, you would know my Father as well. From now on, you do know him and have seen him. Philip said, Lord, show us the Father that we will be, and that will be enough for us. And Jesus answered, Don't you know me, Philip, even after I've been among you such a long time? Anyone who has seen me has seen the Father. How can you say, show us the Father? Don't you believe that I am in the Father and that the Father is in me? The words I say to you are not just my own. Rather, it is the Father living in me who is doing his work. Believe in me when I say that I am the Father and the Father is in me, or at least believe on the evidence of the miracles themselves. I tell you the truth. Anyone who has faith in me will do what I have been doing. He will do even greater things than these because I am going to the Father, and I will do whatever you ask in my name so that the Son may bring glory to the Father. You may ask me for anything in my name, and I will do it. This is the word of the Lord.
Shepherds caring for.
Okay, I want you to take a walk today. Now, I know it varies by individual how far you can walk, but if getting up and walking across the room is the best you can do, then I want you to get up and walk across the room. Now, if you can do better than that, maybe get up and walk to each room of your house. Do that. Now, if you're doing better than that, maybe get outside and walk around your house. For those who are feeling a little more adventurous, walk around the neighborhood, go to a park, find a trail. Some of you run, I know that. And so I encourage you not just to walk, but get out and take a run today. See how far you can go. I want you to get some exercise. We've been in this quarantine, this shelter in place, this sort of fear for a long time, for 8 weeks or something like that. I lose track of how many weeks we've been doing this, just like I lose track of what day it is sometimes right now. But exercise is one of the things that I want you to do, and I'll come back to that in a moment. So keep that in mind, but let's look at a few other things as well. Let's look at this text. This is the Gospel of John, and as John is telling the Gospel, he's just told his disciples that he's going to be betrayed, that he's going to be executed. And you can imagine how troubling that would be to these disciples who have given up everything to follow him. They put their faith in him. They believe he's going to be with them and be their leader for a long time. And then he gives them this news that somebody's going to betray him. And not only that, that he's going to be executed. So their hearts are truly troubled. And this passage begins with that phrase. It's one of my favorites. Do not let your hearts be troubled. I think it speaks to us in this time too, because now I know that many of you are doing well. It's almost a mini vacation. It's nice to be home with your family. It's nice not to be so crazy busy dragging the kids to this or that. Some of you, you're able to work from home, and things are actually really good. And so if that's your situation, keep doing what you're doing. I want you to keep enjoying it. But for a lot of people, I know that at first this was okay, bearable, even kind of interesting and fun. I don't mean fun concerned with everybody getting sick, but I mean, for a lot of people, they're healthy and they're at home and they can watch movies or spend time with loved ones. And frankly, it is kind of fun maybe at first. But over the weeks, it begins to wear on everyone, including me. And I find myself, the novelty is worn off. I begin to get a little bit more lonely, not quite depressed, but something close to that. And then I get to this text that speaks directly to us. It says, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God, trust also in me." Now, I've read that many times. And as I've said, normally it's at a funeral when hearts truly are troubled. This is a text that reminds us that God has gone and prepared a place for us, and that we have a place to go, and that He will be welcoming us there. The perfect text for a funeral, a perfect reassurance that we're in God's hands all the time, even after we have passed away. But today, it still speaks to us in this time of isolation and struggle and depression and whatever else you're facing right now. The message is still true for us today. Jesus looks at us in the state we're in and says, "Don't let your hearts be troubled." And He asks us to trust in Him. Of course, Thomas, when Jesus says that you know the way, Thomas says, "Well, we don't know the way." And Jesus says, and this is a famous verse, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you really knew me, you would know my Father as well. From now on, you do know Him and have seen Him. So a beautiful text about how Jesus is the way. And here's the thing. I think if we were truly able to give ourselves completely over to Jesus Christ, And that any situation we face, we would find ourselves at peace because we would know that we're not in control. And I love how this text ends. It ends with a reminder for us to pray. And he says this. He says, I will do whatever you ask in my name so that the Son may bring glory to the Father. You may ask me for anything in my name and I will do it. And see, I believe that. I believe that that is true. But I think because we live in a broken world, we don't get it quite right. We tend to go by the, you've heard it said, pray as if everything was in God's hands, and then work as if everything is in your hands. Now, we take that, and we end up giving kind of lip service to God. And we think that the real answer is working like everything is in our hands. And we don't really give ourselves over to prayer. And so this is a reminder for us to do just that. To slow down and not just say you're gonna pray. Not just say your prayers in a very quick way to get it over with and then go to work. But slow down and talk to Jesus. Let Him know what's going on in your life. Let Him know what you're worried about and who you're worried about. Let it be a conversation like you were having with a friend or a parent who's there to truly and deeply love you. I think when we begin to slow down and trust Jesus, then our hearts begin to calm down. Then we find ourselves not quite as troubled as we are. But again, we don't live in a perfect world. We live in a very broken world, and that includes us. And so our faith is not always as strong as it should be. Our prayer life is not always what it should be. And so there are things that we can do as well, along with prayer, that will simply help in this time, some practical things. And one of those, as I mentioned, is exercise. Just getting out. Going for a walk, no matter how far you can go, no matter what that means for you, whatever exercise means for you, do that. And you may say, I don't feel like it. I mean, I'm depressed. I don't want to do anything. Well, that's the perfect time to exercise, to get your blood flowing, to remember that there's good out there in the world. And if you can get outside to do it, that's even better, because getting outside really helps us to remember how good God is and all that He has created for us. The sunshine helps us. So exercise, and if you can do it outdoors, get outdoors and exercise. It would be good for you. You've been stuck at home too long. I know you have. Another thing that we need is routine. Now, at first, when this first started, you could kind of wing it, right? I mean, you could kind of do what you needed to do, and you figured you'd be back in the routine soon. But for many of us, we haven't got back in a routine yet. So I encourage you to establish a routine again. I've got friends who said, you know, I don't have to go to work anymore. I can work from home now, and I can, you know, I can get up whenever I want to, so I end up sleeping late, then I stay up late, then I sleep even later. And that's sort of a recipe for disaster. At first it's kind of fun to have that flexibility, but in the long run it's just a recipe for disaster. So get up at a certain time in the morning. Create that routine that reestablishes the just sort of a normal way of life for you. So I want you to exercise. I want you to get outdoors. I want you to reestablish a routine. And as Tully said on his Wednesday morning message, I hope you saw that, I want you to laugh. I want you to find whatever it is that makes you laugh. And for those who struggle to laugh, the thing that makes you smile just a little bit, and do that. Now, it could be a movie. A lot of people, it's a movie. For others, it's a book. One of the things that I can suggest, if you don't have anything in your life to make you laugh, you're on YouTube already. Search YouTube for John Krasinski or something like that. And it's Some Good News, John Krasinski or something like that. I don't know how to spell it. I'll put a link down below and it will cheer you up. You will love it, and it may make you bring tears to your eyes, because he's just using his time to help us see the good in the world. So if you got nothing else to make you smile, find that link down below and click on it, and use that as something to help make you smile and remember the good things in the world. Now, the other thing I want you to do is to help someone. Anyone, your neighbor, a friend, a family member, doesn't matter. Find a way to help someone. That's the way we live out our calling. Just before this passage in the Gospel of John, Jesus reminds his disciples that the way that people will know that they are followers of Jesus Christ is if they love one another. See, that's our example. That's our witness. That's how we let people know we are disciples of Christ. That's how we become the hands and the feet of our Lord Jesus Christ. In this passage, he says that, you know, if you don't believe what I... Here it is. Believe me when I say that I am in the Father and the Father is in me, or at least believe the evidence of the miracles themselves. In other words, believe what I say, but if you're struggling to believe that, then look around and see what's happening. And see, that's where we as Christians, as the body of Christ, can increase that witness in this world, so that people, if they don't really believe the message, they can at least see you loving them. What a miracle and what a opportunity for you to witness to others. And it helps you in this time where nothing's normal and everybody's stuck at home, and you might be slipping into a bit of depression or something like that. Reaching out and helping somebody and loving them helps you and it helps them. I invite you to pray. This ends with an invitation to prayer. And it says, ask and he'll do anything you want. So I invite you to take the time in that routine that I'm asking you to establish. Write it down and pick out a particular time to pray, whether it's in the morning or evening or midday. You can pencil in a nap as well, whatever you need, but put prayer in there. And one of the ways that has been effective for a lot of people to pray is to keep a journal, to write it down, and begin with what you're thankful for. All the things that you're thankful for. What you'll find is there's not enough room to list them all. So let me suggest this. List three things that you're thankful for. And if you can stop there, then transition into praying for others. Things that you would like to be thankful for. Things you would like God to do for others. So this is a text for us who are struggling. It begins with the words, "Do not let your hearts be troubled." It reminds us that Jesus is the way. It reminds us that He answers our prayers. And I'm reminding you on top of that, there's some practical things you can do. Exercise, create a routine, get outdoors, find something that makes you laugh, help somebody, pray, and maybe even write it down in a journal. Keep a journal of what you're grateful for. When you do that, you'll find that your hearts are much less troubled, that you are much less lonely, that you have more energy than you thought you could have had, and that you become a true witness to our Lord Jesus Christ for all the others that are out there suffering in this world. And that's what these disciples are called to do. Jesus was reminding them, tough times are coming, but I'm calling you to continue to trust in me, to follow me, and to love each other. What a beautiful message. Amen.
Thank you.
In response to the good news of the gospel, let us affirm our faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he arose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. Folks, one of the things that we can do no matter what's going on out in the world is that we can pray for each other, we can pray for the community, we can pray for the world, and we can pray for all those who are maybe suffering in one way or another. So at this time, I invite you to please join me in prayer. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we do thank you for all the ways that you bless us and continue to bless us. Lord, we acknowledge that many people are suffering from grief, not just grief from losing someone to death, but losing dreams or losing jobs, losing opportunities, all the things that we count on, Lord, that have been canceled in these past couple months. Lord, we know that it creates a tremendous amount of worry and suffering and grief. And we ask that you send your healing touch among each one in this community and out into the world who find themselves suffering in one way or another. Lord, we pray that you touch them with your healing hand and help them to see the light, see the grace, see the love that they are always surrounded by, because you are always here with us. Lord, we pray to you in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Let us continue our worship with our tithes and offerings. I want you to know that when I got to the church office today, there was a pile of food over by the double doors, which is what I've invited you to do, is to bring food so that we can share it with Rockdale Emergency Relief and the Presbyterian Church of the Resurrection for their food bank. So I want to truly say how thankful I am for your response to that. Also, how thankful I am that every day when I open the mailbox, there's three or four envelopes with checks in them, I imagine. I don't open them. That are contributions to the church, financial contributions, and I appreciate you continuing to give in that manner, even though we're not able to gather here. I want to add one more thing, one more way of giving. You know, we have historically been supporters of Family Promise. We do that by providing 3 or 4 weeks per year where we invite people into our church. We let them sleep here, we provide meals, and we have folks that spend the night and take care of those folks for 1 week. Right now, Family Promise is not able to do that, so they're housing their guest at the day center over by Smyrna Presbyterian Church. They don't need food, and they don't really need volunteers. What they could use is money. So we're scheduled to host that group later in May. And so what I want to do is invite you to contribute to a one-time offering. So instead of hosting Family Promise for a week, I want to invite you to make a contribution, financial contribution to Family Promise over the next week or two, you can mail in a check to Conyers Presbyterian and just let us know that it's supposed to go to Family Promise. And we're trying to figure out a way to allow you to do that over the internet. So I will notify you by email if we're able to do that. So we invite you to continue to contribute and support the church. We invite you to continue to bring canned goods and dry goods by if you are able to do that. And now we also, just for the next 2 weeks, want to invite you to do additional giving to the Family Promise ministry. And they need money so that they can pay their bills by housing everybody in the day center. They've got to run the air condition, lights, and so their bills have increased dramatically. And instead of hosting, we can help pay the bills for that particular week. Anyway, I invite you to do that. Again, I'm thankful for all the many ways that you have been continuing to support the ministry of this church. And I invite you now to join me in prayer. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we do thank you for the opportunity to give. We thank you for all the ways that you bless us and continue to bless us. And we ask that that those efforts that we make at giving back, whether they are financial or food or just surrounding somebody with your love and your grace, we ask that you bless those efforts and that you use them to share your love and your grace all through this community and throughout this world in this particular time of the year. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. And now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you now and evermore. Amen.